time to be having a debate about capitalism and climate change, because this is a big year for climate change campaigning. Because as I'm sure many of you know, we have at the end of this year, we have the Global Summit coming up in Paris, which is the really, this is really honestly the last chance, we really mean it this time. So, you know, to have a global agreement that will reduce emissions. This really is the last chance to keep emissions at a manageable level. And it's interesting, when I was sort of preparing this talk, I was thinking back to how, you know, where we were with sort of climate change campaigning before the last really big This Is the Last Chance summit in Copenhagen, which was, what, 5 years ago? And it's interesting to think how much the sort of the landscape of campaigning has changed in those 5 years. Because in the run-up to Copenhagen, what we thought what we were facing then was actually a resurgence of climate change denial. We had the climate gate, if you remember, when the University of East Anglia's servers were hacked, and they found, and climate change deniers released all these emails that they said proved that it was all an evil plot by left-wing academics and things. So there was kind of a, you know, we thought that actually we were going to have to spend the next 5 years convincing people that climate change is happening. And that really has gone away again now. I mean, there's still the lunatic fringe and people in America who think it's not happening and it's sunspots or whatever. But that is now reduced back down really to the lunatic fringe. So the big debate about climate change now, it's not, is it happening, are we causing it? Because the answer to that, pretty much now we have consensus, is yes and yes. The big debate is, okay, well, what do we do about it? And this is kind of odd, really, for the climate change movement, because we're often not very specific about what we do about it, what we're calling for governments and people to do. I don't know if many of you were on the People's Climate March last September, and one of the main placards, I think it was Nawaz's placard, but I might be wrong about that, but one of the main placards just said, do something about climate change, which, okay, but it's kind of unspecific, and you're not usually that unspecific on any other sort of demo. You know, you don't go on a Stop the War demo and say, do something about the war. You're kind of usually a bit more sort of demanding than that. So it kind of, it's, you know, it's interesting that after so long about campaigning about climate change, and after, if you think about it, the Kyoto Protocol is, what, 1992? That's more than 20 years ago. Some people in this room probably weren't even born when we had the Kyoto Protocol. And we're still at the stage of what the hell do we do about this? And this, I think, indicates that there is a fundamental problem with the way that, that capitalism can or can't respond to climate change. We're not just facing kind of inertia and not wanting to believe that it's happening. We're up against really a structural problem here. So I thought, well, it's useful to think, well, what might that problem be? So the first thing to say is that it's really not a technological problem. I mean, sometimes when you talk about climate change, people will look all knowing and they say, oh, well, it's all because we haven't got nuclear fusion yet, or things like that. But that is not the issue. There's been quite a lot of reports now that have established that actually we could get all the power that we use now from renewable sources. We don't need to wait for someone to invent better battery technology, or that would be nice, you know, better ways of storing renewable energy. We don't need for people to invent better solar panels, although, yeah, cool, you know, things can always be improved. Basically, the technology that we've got now, we could generate all the power needs of all the developed economies on the planet right now, today. We don't have to invent anything else. So it's not an issue of technology. So, okay, well, if, in a sense, it's so easy to solve quite a large part of the problem, well, why aren't we doing it? And the problem, first of all, is, of course, that while, you know, we have the technology to generate all our energy without causing greenhouse gas emissions, we don't have a mechanism in the current system to get there. Because what we've seen, or what I think we've established now, is that there's not really a way of using a market system to get from the current energy mix to a 100% renewable one. It doesn't really work. And this isn't because you can't make any money at all at generating renewable energy, but it's just not as attractive to private companies as building an enormous new nuclear power station is. That's much more capital intensive, it's much more profitable. It kind of works better. So the problem is, I think, is partly an ideological one, that actually if we wanted to shift to 100% renewable infrastructure, what that would need is for the government to decide, right, we are going to have a massive new programme of public expenditure and we are just going to get on and I'm going to do this, government spending, because it's a priority for people and for the planet. And that kind of gives you the clue for why we haven't done this. Because after all, we have a government which is fundamentally committed to not having a public sector. You know, if they're cutting welfare benefits, they're imposing the bedroom tax, they're privatising the NHS, they're not going to spend public money on the energy infrastructure. Their whole ideology, the ideology of austerity, is about having this in the private sector. It's just what private energy companies want to do, and they can just get on with it, and the government isn't going to be involved. They're so little involved that they announced recently that they're actually cutting the subsidy for wind farms, because it's all just up to the market. So part of what we're up against is the ideology of the Tory government. And this really underlines, I think, why the fight for real action on climate change is and has to be a central part of the struggle against austerity. And why those of us who care about climate change really have to be involved in the People's Assembly, part of that campaign, because it is the same fight. You know, the fight to protect the NHS from privatisation, the fight to save our welfare state, it is the same fight to get real action on climate change, because it's the ideology of austerity that is a large part of what we're up against. And that also, I think, partly tells us that, well, we can win victories here. The thing about the fight against austerity is it's not a fight that, okay, we're only going to win when we have the revolution. You know, these are things that we can fight for now and we can hope to win now. And in fact, I don't know if you might have seen this week, campaigners in Holland won a really significant victory that a Dutch court actually said that the Dutch government was acting illegally by not reducing emissions, because they were harming the rest of the world, and that's against the law. And the Dutch government, quite unbelievably, is thinking about appealing that. So it'd be quite interesting to see how they're going to argue that, no, we're quite justified in cooking the entire planet. That isn't illegal at all. So we'll see what happens there. But that shows that actually this is a fight where we can think, well, actually, no, if we build a big enough movement, a strong enough movement, and last Saturday's demo was a really good example of how we're starting, we're at the beginning of that, we can hope that we can bring real steps to real action on climate change out of the government. So I think in a way this is a way that actually is quite a hopeful picture, in a sense that we should be feeling, yeah, we are powerful, we can do something about this. But having said that, I think we do have to recognise that there are kind of deeper structural problems which make it very difficult for capitalism to deal with climate change. So the first one really is that capitalism doesn't assign a value to natural resources. It kind of just assumes that, you know, the natural world is just kind of there, and, you know, you use it, and when it's used up, well, you use something else, and who cares, you know. And there've been attempts, quite a lot of attempts, to try and bring kind of natural resources into the market by pricing them. I mean, there've been attempts to give a market value to carbon emissions so that you can then trade not emitting the carbon and so on. So, you know, there's been some markets in carbon emissions and so on. So this is an attempt to make capitalism take account of the damage that it does to the natural world. And the problem with that is that it really hasn't worked very well. I mean, there's been all the attempts to create, you know, to make capitalism take account of it. But the problem with doing it through a market system is that markets really are designed for one thing. They're designed to make profit. And they don't really do anything else particularly effectively, and anything else that they do is kind of a side benefit, it's not the point. So what's happened with attempting to get capitalist markets to take account of climate change is that it's kind of commodified a whole new area of things for capitalists to make profits on. My favourite example, it's not precisely emissions, but it's great anyway, is that in particularly the American market, you can trade and make money from hypothetical woodpecker futures. Now this is permits where you get credit for not cutting down trees and therefore allowing hypothetical future woodpeckers to live, and you can trade these. Oh, they're bonds, they're traded on the bond market, I think. So people make money out of this. I haven't seen anything that shows that actually it's helped any actual woodpeckers. So it's just become, you know, another part of capitalism. It hasn't reduced emissions at all. So this is an issue we're trying to make capitalism respond to it. Another issue is really the issue about growth, that capitalism is all about growth. I'm going to kind of slightly disagree with David Harvey here, which I know is a really dangerous thing to do, but basically, putting it very broadly, because there is a tendency within capitalism for the rate of profit to decline, for reasons that I'm not going to discuss, because I don't want to have an argument with David Harvey, therefore capitalism has to grow. Because if you can't, if you try and stay still, your profits go down ultimately over time. So this is true if you're an individual capitalist company. I remember many years ago when I had the misfortune to actually work in the private sector, my boss was always saying, we have to grow or we'll die. And that was actually true, and we didn't grow and we died, and that's why I got out, so yay. But that's, yeah, it's true for private companies and it's true for the economy as a whole. Capitalism has to grow. And there's been various attempts, which I think I probably don't have quite time to go into, but we can talk about in the questions, to try and say, well, actually, can we either have capitalism without growth? And there's been various attempts to argue for this. I don't think that anyone's made a convincing case. Or can we kind of decouple growth from environmental damage? Can we have growth only in intangible things? So it would all just be selling services or selling stuff on the internet, and therefore that wouldn't cause any environmental damage. I think the problem with that is actually finding a genuinely intangible service that doesn't, at some point down the line, involve any environmental damage. I mean, from a consumer's point of view, having a book on your iPad rather than a physical book, it might seem like, yes, this is the way of the future, there's no physical thing. But yeah, you don't have a physical book, but the book, the electronic book, is sitting on a server somewhere in Nevada or something in a big silo that's made of concrete and it's got air conditioning and people drive to it. And actually, this is not intangible and it's not without environmental damage. So I think there are problems here with the idea that we can somehow get away from growth within capitalism. Because this is a system that says it has to grow. It doesn't work without it. And the other reason I think that there's a fundamental problem with capitalism is that actually capitalism is a uniquely destructive system. Because it's only within capitalism that elites don't have to care about the destruction that they do. If you think about other systems, if, for example, you are a feudal lord, you might be very rich and powerful, you have lots and lots of serfs, lots and lots of castles, king does whatever you say, you know, it's great. The reason why you're powerful is because you own certain lands which are very productive. And if you, for example, decide to cut down all the trees on your land and then all the topsoil washes off and you can't grow anything anymore, you lose your money. You're not powerful anymore. If actually all your serfs run away because you're so nasty to them, and then you can't do anything on your land, you can't produce anything, you lose your money and you lose your power. So you have to, if you're a feudal lord, care for your serfs a bit and care for your land, because that's where your power is based. If you're a capitalist and you make money because you own lots of land, you can cut down all the trees, let all the topsoil wash off, and you can say, well, I will take my money, my capital, and I'll invest it on the other side of the world. And all the people who now can't live on this land because it's been completely deforested, well, fuck them. I don't have to care. I've got my money. And this is the fundamental difference with capitalism, that they do not have to care structurally about the environmental damage that they cause, because they can take their capital out and they can put it somewhere else. And I've never seen any sort of convincing explanation of how we could get away from this structural problem, how we can make them care. Because it's not about individuals, it's about the system. And the system is structured so that it doesn't care. And the other sort of problem that's related to that is that actually natural disasters are terrible for the people involved, but they're bleeding profitable. If you look at what's happened, for example, in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina, for the people of New Orleans, it's a terrible thing and it remains a terrible thing, particularly for the poorest people in New Orleans. For the capitalists who've been able to clear poor black people out of whole neighborhoods and make them into luxury areas where they can sell lots of new apartments and have lots of, you know, really expensive businesses and so on, selling to the new well-heeled people who've moved in. It's been great. You know, I'm sure they think, right, this is a really great model to follow. Disaster capitalism is a real thing. So there are serious problems here with the system that we have. And I know I'm running out of time, so I'll say it very quickly. There are two conclusions that you could draw from this. The first conclusion is people think, right, there's a problem with the system, so therefore we as individuals or in small groups should just withdraw from the system. We should just say, well, we're not going to participate in the market, we're going to try and be as self-sufficient as possible and just kind of get out of it. And if everyone did that, then the system would collapse. I don't really have time to go into an explanation of why that doesn't work, but I would just say that it's really, really important when people show that actually a different way of living is possible. It really demonstrates that when some people say, well, it's all just because humans are greedy and selfish, you'll never change human nature and all that kind of crap, that is actually crap. that we can live in a different way. We're not all addicted to having 6 iPads or whatever. You know, this isn't our fault, this is the system's fault. But you don't bring down the system just by withdrawing on the individually or on a, you know, small group level from the system. Capitalism is quite happy to live with small groups of people who kind of live in communes, or small groups of people who have a communist mayor like they do in a village in Spain. It's fine with that. The only way that we will defeat this system is by organising for defeating this system, which is partly campaigning and broad campaigns to the People's Assembly, but also being groups of organised revolutionaries who know that ultimately where we're going is bringing down the system. My very final point is it's remarkable that actually something quite often it's the most middle class areas where you get this, where you talk about climate change and there's someone in the audience who says, oh, well, you see, yeah, you're right, we'll never do anything about climate change until we have the revolution. And that's not true to an extent, because I think we can win concessions from the government. But kind of very broadly, it is true. But when they say that to me in leafy outer London suburbs in Zone 5, you know, they mean, oh, well, there's nothing we can do. Actually, I think, yeah, we do need a revolution ultimately to deal with climate change, but I think we can have a revolution. And that's the message I want to leave you with.
Thank you very much, Elaine. Matthew Bennett.
Well, thank you very much, and it's great to see everyone here on a Sunday morning, although having just come back from Glastonbury, I'm kind of, it looks really strange, you're not all covered in mud. That's what audiences are supposed to look like. But anyway, I thought I'd start off by talking a little bit about the climate change aspect of this topic and then move into the capitalism. And I think what we need to do is tackle despair and tackle feelings that many of us have in Britain, that it's too late, it's all hopeless, you know, we've blown it. And I think that's an understandable British perspective when you look at the fact that some of the things Elaine referred to, that we have a government that's utterly opposed to onshore wind because it's going to cost too much, despite the fact that onshore wind is the cheapest form of renewable energy currently available in Britain. Despite the fact that we have a government that thinks that fracking is a significant part of Britain's energy future, even though actually even the fracking industry doesn't say that it's a significant part of Britain's energy future. And one to watch out for this week, we're expecting the Davies Commission to report on airports runways in the southeast. And now I have actually prepared, just in case, some quotes saying, isn't it great they've recognised there's no need for extra airport capacity in the southeast? But I'm not really expecting to have to use them, I'm afraid. But we are very much influenced by that perspective from Britain. And it's interesting because it's changed a lot in the last couple of years, because, as Elaine said, we have seen a move from the climate change deniers onto different arguments. And a couple of years ago, I also had a lot of people saying, well, Britain only produces 2% of the greenhouse gases now being produced. You know, there's no point in us trying anyway. And that's true, but interestingly, the other side have stopped saying that to me, because what they were saying then was, oh, you know, China and India and other places are powering ahead, so there's just no point in us doing anything. But actually, when you take a global perspective, there are lots of good, positive things happening on climate change. Now, Elaine referred to the Dutch court case, which I think is very exciting. And I actually looked up the Dutch constitution and where this actually draws from, where this ruling comes from. And I think this is an interesting sentence in the Dutch constitution. It shall be the concern of the authorities to keep the country habitable and protect and improve the environment. Now, as Elaine said, you know, it's interesting that the government is thinking about challenging that court ruling, that it's their duty to keep the country habitable. But, you know, I've seen a lot of discussion on the email list of people saying, could we do the same thing in Britain? Well, maybe we need a written constitution first and a different kind of political system to do that. Which brings me to my broader point in bringing in capitalism and bringing in the political aspect of this. Because Elaine said she was referring to the Climate March placards that said, do something. And actually, what we have to do, not just for climate change, but for the economic, social and political crisis we've got to do now, is not just do something, but change everything. And that's what we've got to do. It's quite easy, really. It's only two words. We can pretty well tick that one off. But in a way, the need to change everything makes things easier. I think if you look back to Copenhagen, as Elaine was doing, back then we were just fresh into the economic crisis, that people just thought, oh, it's an economic crisis. They mightn't have put it quite in these terms, but we know that capitalism has regular economic crises. We'll go through this and come out the other side and things will continue as they were before. And yet actually now we're going into the Paris climate talks and practically nobody really believes that the world's going swimmingly, economically, socially, or politically. I mean, you couldn't, you really, really couldn't. I mean, you might have David Cameron saying, oh, look at Britain's economic figures. But you've got an awful lot of economists, even economists for organisations like the Financial Times, pointing out that we have, you know, our economic growth at the moment is built on house prices, a boom in the London and the South East, and consumer debt. And nothing could possibly go wrong with that. So, you know, we have very obviously this week, very immediately, the Greek crisis. And I would second the call to go, if you can, on Monday to Trafalgar Square. I'll be there if I can. And to really think about how the Greek people are facing today and the next day, and what it's like to live with that level of uncertainty about the future of your whole economic system. Will the banks open tomorrow? And it is worth thinking about the fact that actually in Britain, we were in that situation, but we didn't know it. We know now that we got to the point in the financial crash that we were about 6 hours from the ATMs, the cash machines, stopping working. We didn't know it at the time, but we know now. And that tells us just how fragile our financial system is. And that has to change. And that's part of the whole package of that we need to really get the idea across. And it's not easy and it's not simple, but you know, financial reform is a climate change issue. Social reform is a climate change issue. Decent benefits are a climate change issue. How can people possibly think about what their consumption's like, how they might reduce their consumption, how they might live in a healthier way, if they're desperately thinking, how in the hell am I going to put food on the table tomorrow or keep a roof over my head next week? We need to change everything, and that's the climate change issue, and it's a huge political issue for all of us. Just before the election, I was on the Today programme. I always enjoy going on the Today programme. And it was, they always come up with a new way of asking really stupid questions. You have to keep your temper. That's the challenge. But I was being challenged that the Green Party wasn't talking about climate change enough. And the question was, you're talking about public transport. You're talking about housing and insulating housing. And you're not talking about climate change. And I kind of took a deep breath and went, well, if we get good public transport that's affordable, reliable, and runs when people want it, then they don't have to use their cars. And that might just have a climate change impact. I wasn't quite that sarcastic, because you can't be, but I would have liked to have been. And the Green Party has always said that economic and social justice are indivisible, that these things go together. And behind that is our current model, our system has failed us economically, socially, environmentally, and we have to change. And I think, as Elaine identified very well, there's a real structural problem, because actually the changes we need to make for climate change are a huge threat to entrenched interests. And yet there's huge public support for those changes. I was actually up in Preston, Lancashire, last Wednesday. When we thought we were going to get the ruling from the County Council on the fracking application up there. Now, it was really great. I was there on the second day of the protest. Monday had been the big day, and there was probably 1,000 people there, and I'm told it was enormous. But even on the Tuesday, there were a couple hundred people there, and lots of placards and lots of honk to show your support. And as I was saying to the BBC man who was interviewing me live whilst we were yelling over the car horns, well, I think the public support is obvious here, because pretty well two-thirds of the cars driving past were showing their support audibly, or giving a thumbs up or waving or whatever. And I particularly enjoyed, and I was careful to tell everyone, don't take a photo of it because you'll get into trouble, the British gas van, who the guy, the driver, honked his support for the fracking van. But we don't want to get into trouble. But you know, there's a big fight there, and I think this ties into the point that Elaine was making in terms about getting together and fighting and joining up these issues. Because actually what I've seen since the election is there was an understandable, the first 24 hours shock, despair even. People going, how are we going to live with a Tory government for another 5 years, if indeed it does turn out to be 5 years, I don't think it will. People were really shocked, but what people have done now, and I'm seeing this up and down the country in all kind of different ways, is people have got determined. And they're really starting to join the dots up, really starting to see that we need not just dealing with one issue like fracking, not just dealing with one issue like making the minimum wage a living wage, but we have to change the whole system. And I saw this really about 10 days after the election. The first time I really saw it starting to coalesce was in Sheffield. And there was an anti-austerity march in Sheffield, 10 days after the election, so organised at very short notice. And 1,000 people came out in Sheffield, and 1,000 people in Sheffield is a really decent sized march. But what I really liked was not only were there all the obvious people there, the NHS, Keep Our NHS Public people, the People's March for the NHS, anti-eviction campaigners, the really strong campaigners for a decent asylum system, which Sheffield's particularly noted for. But there was also there a group of young teachers, and their campaign issue was, let's stop testing our primary pupils so much. And you think about it, and you start to think about that in a whole holistic context. They'd seen that the anti-austerity cause was their cause, that having a whole schooling system that's designed to turn out utterly disciplined people with the skills that certain kind of employers want is promulgating the system. And they were saying we want a different kind of system. And like, we know that if we're going to improve the health of our young people, we need to give them chance, more exposure to green space. They need to know, have the chance to learn about ecology in a hands-on mud's pie kind of way, not just in an academic kind of way. They're going to have to learn and spend time doing a whole lot of stuff that isn't going to get them a higher score in the SATs. And it's all joined up. The system has to change. And there is a growing movement, you know, the kind of size of the audience here this morning, what I'm seeing up and down the country, the, of course, spectacularly large, and we can argue whether it was 250,000 or not, but let's claim it anyway. It was big, it was huge, I was in the middle of it. You know, people are coming out, and they're coming out from all kind of different angles. And so I'd urge everyone, whatever your particular pet, you know, we've all got something that's just close to our heart, the thing that got us into politics, the thing we're really passionately engaged with. Do that, work on that, but also reach out to different groups, different organisations, and keep in mind the way that the economic change, changing the financial sector, providing decent wages and benefits for everyone who needs them, dealing with climate change, they're all part of the same change that we need. And you will find people, you'll run into people who say, oh, you know, you can't be realistic. In fact, I had a Labour MP yesterday in Tottenham who accused me of, you're just being utopian. But I think I'm being utterly realistic. We cannot continue as we are. When we look at the climate change side of things, it's actually not politics. It's physics that tells us we cannot continue as we are. But it's our humanity and decency that tells us that the economics, the way we're treating so many people in our society, the disabled who are facing a life of misery and fear, people who are struggling to get a job, people who are struggling to put food on the table, none of this can continue. It's entirely realistic to say it all has to change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. And now this is time for questions or points that you want to raise. If you can raise your hands, please. And have we got somebody with a microphone? Is someone going around with a mic? Yep, just wait 1 minute. Yep, if we can come to the lady there first.
Thank you. Thank you both. I think the psychological aspect to dealing with the challenge to our future, our long-term future, in taking on board climate change and being serious about doing something about it, is something that hasn't been mentioned so far, and I see that as very significant, both for business owners and also for the population at large. Also, I want to tie in with that the question about the way in which capitalism also destroys value. So it's the short-termism, the way in which capitalism eats itself, as I think, was it the Bank of England guy said, used that term? So dealing with climate change is about sustainability in the long term. So it's challenging the current model of capitalism, which is so short term, which does destroy value. And I think capitalism has changed over time. You know, the amount of financialization and speculation is not how it's always been in the past. So I think that I'm just adding in questions in about the context within which we are operating.
Thank you. And the lady at the back there on the right. Yes. The microphone is coming to you now. Yeah.
Hi. Thank you, Natalie and Elaine. Brilliant talk. I just would like to perhaps, if Natalie could mention something about the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, and how that relates to the problem that we have campaigning around climate change, what the implications of that would be if it was signed, and what we can do to try and prevent it from being signed, in particular the ISDS, the Interstate Dispute Settlement, and how important it is for organisations like Counterfire, any socially progressive organisations, to take on board campaigning against the TTIP. Thank you.
Thank you. And the gentleman here with the picture.
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up first on something that Elaine mentioned, coming as I do from Suffolk, in the shadow of possibly two more nuclear power stations. Nuclear power stations aren't profitable unless the government is damn stupid enough to subsidise them. And the European Commission looked at Hinkley and decided that, against what the government was saying, it's actually going to cost something like $28 billion to build two nuclear power stations. And that really isn't what we need, and it isn't how we should be dealing with our stuff. So even capitalism can't make sense of nuclear power, but for some reason the politicians of all the three main parties seem to be stuck on it, and they must have some hidden agenda that they're not prepared to tell us about, and I haven't found what it is, and I'm continuing to dig. But certainly nuclear isn't even low carbon. It does seem to me that one of the big issues is that what we've got to get away from is the industrial scale production of energy, because if we do it on a small scale, on all the roofs that are all over the place, actually that's a much more effective way of doing it. It doesn't help the capitalist system, though, because they like an industrial scale operation. And somehow we've got to get them away from that. But actually what I like is Natalie's suggestion, we have to change the whole system, and that's absolutely right. And when we do that, then maybe all this will resolve itself.
Thank you very much. Shall we just take some of those points now, 2 minutes from each speaker, and then we'll come back out for some more questions, if that's... Natalie, do you want to go first?
All right, well, I'll start on TTIP, just because it's what on my page. First of all, a plea to everyone. I kind of assume that everyone in this room knows what TTIP means, but generally speaking, whenever you're talking about TTIP, don't get caught in the acronym trap. I always say the proposed EU-US free trade deal known as TTIP. I know that's a large mouthful, but we need to get the news about this, the information out about this, out to a much broader audience. All of us in this room, probably most of our friends know about it. If you went out on the street out there and did a sample of 100 people, you might get 5 maybe. So we've got to make sure we talk about this in a really accessible kind of way that reaches everybody. That's my little pet plea on this subject. It is a clear threat to tackling with climate change, basically because it's a threat to states having any kind of rules for the common good, rules for the future even. You think about how TTIP might conflict with that sentence from the Dutch constitution that I read out. But what happens if it interferes with profits? Then the secret ISDS settlement procedures gonna have to weigh up the profits versus keeping the state habitable. And of course, we'll never know how they even did that if we did it under that procedure. So it's, you know, I would agree that we need to urge everyone to keep campaigning on this. We are making some real traction on this. I thought actually about a year ago in the FT, there was an article saying we might have to drop ISDS from the treaty. And I thought, yes, we're really making some impact here. So keep fighting, keep talking about it, but keep making sure we're spreading beyond our usual network so that a broader range of people know about it. The nuclear power thing. Actually, I think it's worth thinking about the kind of subsidies, as you say, that are needed to make it quote-unquote profitable. This is actually true in so many other areas. You know, we have a huge benefits culture in Britain. Benefits going to housing private landlords who are benefiting from housing benefit and mortgage tax rate relief. We have huge corporate benefits for companies who are allowed to pay their staff less than the living wage, a minimum wage much lower than that. So actually corporate profits are actually subsidised hugely across a whole range of areas in Britain, and nuclear power is actually just one example of it. And I think I tend not towards the conspiracy theory of you know, you say the hidden agenda. I think it's more just this is a big, huge scale thing where the company, where the government is dealing with, you know, it's big multinational companies, and that's what it likes to do. You know, by contrast, there's a in Lancashire in Worley, I visited a wonderful little project, not a big scale, to put an Archimedes screw in the river in the village. Three people basically dedicated 2 years of their life to fighting the system to eventually put it in, and it's now there and installed. And you know, one of the challenges they encountered was the fact that, you know, this is a conservation area and you're building a small, very low slung shed in stone in the style of the region, but it's a conservation area. And just over the field was the farmer's barn, blue and plastic, but it was all set up to try and stop that little small-scale thing, and it was just because the whole system wasn't geared to supporting democratic, small-scale, local energy. It's all set up to deal with a big, you know, Chinese, French, multinational coming in. And that's, you know, the whole relocalization of our economy, relocalization of our politics is a really key thing. In terms of the psychological aspect question, I think there's two things here. I mean, one of the things we've really got to be careful about, and I think, you know, we were stereotyped as the green movement overall in the past of sort of going, it's climate change and you've all got to change your ways or you and the polar bears are going to die. And we actually know that that's not a great way to get people to do things. They're more likely to go, oh hell, I'll just go out and, you know, get drunk and not think about it. So, you know, we need to actually talk about how in dealing with climate change we can tackle all the other issues as well. And this is a positive. Building to deal with climate change deals with all of our other problems as well. So that positive and hope message, I think, is really, really key in tackling this sort of psychological challenge. And the other side of it, I suppose, is, you know, we are taking on a huge industry, the advertising industry, which is out there at a huge scale telling people all the time that your problems will be solved if you buy the latest whatever. And I think one of the things that I'd really like to see people doing some more work on is tackling the advertising industry, starting to restrict the advertising industry. Now, in the Green Party, we passed a couple of years ago a policy that I think is a good one, to say ban all advertising directly directed at the under 11s, because there's actually very good evidence, peer-reviewed evidence, that shows under 11s can't tell the difference between advertising and programs. Their brains just aren't developed for it. So tackle, really, and I'd urge people to think about starting to do that. I'd like to see something done about alcohol advertising, given the huge problem Britain has with alcohol and the fact that you'll get bombarded. You know, for a while there in the tube, there was these sort of human-sized pints of cider coming at you from every corner. So, you know, if we're thinking about the psychology of our society, I think advertising's an area we've really got to look at.
Thank you. Thanks, Natalie. Elaine?
Well, also, starting with the nuclear power issue, I mean, I think, you're right, of course, that it's not a question of, well, what form of energy generation makes profits if it's not subsidised, because pretty much all of them have to be subsidised, otherwise people, individuals, ultimately would have to pay far too high energy, you know, costs for their energy. It's not an industry in the way that it works now that actually would make money if it was completely just left to itself, which is absolutely true. But the question, as you say, is why does the government choose to subsidise nuclear power and not renewable energy? And I think, you know, the answer actually is in a sense in the question, that it is because actually this industrial scale generation is preferable for capital than very much smaller scale, less capital intensive projects. Because the thing about a nuclear power station, it costs millions and millions and millions of pounds. That's millions of pounds that then can be put into it and can generate a return for investors. That's more attractive than lots of little small scale projects which don't look like investment opportunities. This is how capitalism looks at these things. So I don't think there has to be a kind of a hidden agenda. I think the hidden agenda is this is how capitalism works. And that's why you get subsidies for nuclear power stations and you don't get subsidies for wind farms anymore. But TTIP, I think Natalie is absolutely right, and the questioner is absolutely right, that this is something we need to be getting out there, that this would be a massive barrier for everything we're campaigning for. Every time we're calling for something that, okay, the market won't do this anyway, but we need actually government to just do this. You know, TTIP would be a way of stopping us from winning, because that would be, if it's not profitable, it's not in favour of the market, then actually, you can't do it. So we have to be talking about this, but we do have to be, as Natalie said, getting it out there in very clear language, because I think a lot of people know kind of like, oh yeah, TTIP, that's a bad thing. But if you then try and ask them, well, actually, specifically, what is it, and specifically, how is it bad? I think they would have more of a difficulty. And this is part of the problem, actually, with how the media talks about it, that it kind of becomes this thing on the finance page that you skip past, you know. So I think we have a bit of a job there to get the word out there a bit more, I think. The psychological aspects of dealing with climate change, I mean, yeah, I think this has been a problem with the issue, that it's felt to people be a very, very kind of amorphous issue that's kind of up there, and it's something that's going to happen in 50 years' time, and there's not anything that individuals can do about it. And I think there's two ways of approaching this. You could say that, well, the way to deal with this is just to kind of keep on going on to people, that actually they as an individual can do things about it by changing their own individual life. You know, they can change their lifestyle choices, and that actually has an effect, which kind of, in a way, can seem empowering because it's saying to people that they can do something. But the problem with that is that it then is kind of addressing them as consumers, and it's implying that the problem is people's individual lifestyle choices. So I think the better way to get over that problem, that it feels very disconnected to people's individual lives, is actually making the connections with things like the fight against austerity, pointing out that it's part of those fights. And actually, it's not about changes that people might or might not make to their individual lifestyle. That's not actually where the solutions come. The solutions will come from large scale action that actually we need to force governments to do. And that's the way of getting around the kind of feeling of disempowerment that people can have on climate change. That, well, actually, when you're out on the streets fighting against austerity, you are also fighting for action to stop, you know, to reduce carbon emissions and stop climate change from happening.
Thank you very much, Elaine. Can we take some more questions, some points? So there's the gentleman here, and then if we go to the lady in front here. Microphone's just going to you.
I'm on the right.
I would like to tell you that neither atmosphere is limitless, nor natural resources is limitless. So it is very, very, very crucial that we know that those supposedly denying that the climate change is not really happening, it's wrong. So coming back to first above fossil fuels and the dangers of nuclear powers. Those two are issues that we got to fight against them. However, there is another point, and it is that as capitalism, producing for profit, not producing for the need of society, so they are pumping commodity to this society. as Marx says, creating commodity fetishism. So too many cars are produced, too many commodities are produced, and a big industry as the advertisement, as a tool in order to create a psychology for the people in order to buy. So it means that in addition to preventing using fossil fuels and not extending power station, the point is that a big chunk of production itself is raping the natural resources, and as a result, for that reason, in addition to those aspects, we got to consider that this irrational producing and creating mentality that for instance the lady locks that just going to shop and buying the clothes, for instance, that clothes, I'm finishing. So all this extra community producing a lot of energy and destroying the environment.
Just before we go on to our next question, can I just add something to the gentleman who's just spoken? Just asking a question really about the sort of role of economic growth in this debate. Something you often hear said in the sort of environmental movements and the green movements is, you know, you can't have infinite growth on a finite planet, but which, you know, sounds very logical. There was a sort of left, wasn't there, though, that talked about resources in terms of how they were socially created. Resources are socially created. So if you've got some sand on a beach, well, it's not really a resource until human ingenuity is kind of applied to that sand. And then when you apply that human ingenuity, it becomes something like glass, and you can produce bottles and everything like that. And so our, you know, it does that phrase make sense, the finite planet, when actually human ingenuity is a limitless resource, and we can keep on using human ingenuity to find new resources and build new resources. I wondered if we could just address this point of economic growth at some point in this session. The lady in front.
Two questions, I'll try and keep them reasonably brief. First one primarily for Natalie. I'm in the Green Party, I stood in the local elections. I'm also a socialist, and I believe that there's no social justice without environmental justice, the other way around. No progress with green issues without socialism and vice versa. So I don't believe that individual lifestyle choices can bring about, environmental change. It does need to be, we need to change everything, it needs to be systemic. So the question for Natalie is, should we be unabashedly socialist? I mean, I'm all about praxis rather than dogma, but I don't believe we should shy away from, you know, the word socialism. Question for both Natalie and Elaine. Linked to socialism. I'm a founder of 909 Call for the NHS, who organised the People's March last year. And we've been invited by the NUM to march at the Gala, the Durham Miners Gala this year. I do believe passionately in the labour movement. I don't believe we ought to reopen the coal mines or anything like that. And it is primarily now, you know, a celebration of the labour movement, of working class culture. I live in County Durham. I did find out that apparently, and it is allegedly, if somebody can contradict me if I'm wrong, that the Green Party aren't actually allowed to have a stall at the Gala, which I think is sad. Obviously, within the labour movement, there are forces that are not completely opposed to fracking, because in the long term, it can create jobs. I mean, I'm completely opposed to fracking, obviously. So how do we square that circle between the labour movement and environmental justice, and embed, you know, the need for clean, green technologies in the labour movement, for creating green jobs, for having that systemic change that means that everyone can have a solar panel, because I'd love to have solar panels, but I can't afford them. And it's not about lifestyle change, it's about we need, you know, a systemic change and investment in green jobs.
Thank you. And the lady in the white top here. Microphone's just coming. Oh, sorry. Yeah, if you could just pass it along here, thanks.
Hi, my comment kind of links on to what the ladies just said. I'm from Cumbria, and we don't like the fact that we've got a Sellafield on our doorstep. We're all terrified of it. We don't want another nuclear power station. We hate the fact that our Lake District is going to be destroyed with more nuclear waste dumped underneath it. But the dilemma that we face is that many of our family members rely on employment for Sellafield, including my own husband. And I honestly don't know what would happen to my area if it wasn't there, as much as I hate it.
Thank you. Just take a few more points. The lady there in the yellow top, and then the gentleman at the back, yeah.
I wonder if you could say something about built-in obsolescence, which I think is started in the 50s, and it's leading to flimsier and flimsier clothing, crappier and crappier appliances. Is this okay? Yeah, okay. And the oceans are full of plastic. Plastic is made mainly out of petrol products, yeah? Well, so how do we get around that? Because, I mean, if you walk down a high street, all the shops that have stuff outside, everything's made out of plastic. I mean, what kind of a world are we going to be able to make without, I mean, if the petrol does stay in the ground and so on, so if you could comment on that.
Thank you. And then the gentleman at the back, and then we'll come back to the panel.
Yeah, hi, my name's Lewis. I'm from the Campaign Against Climate Change Steering Group. And I just wanted to agree with what Elaine said right at the beginning about how important 2014 is for the climate movement, because the talks in Paris will provide a real focus for climate activists. But I do think we have to approach them with our heads screwed on. And, you know, the consensus amongst most climate activists at the moment is that the talks will not deliver the kind of solutions we need. And that's not because we're being cynical or, you know, we're just cynical lefties. I think if you look at the scale of the problem, the fact that we need to keep more than 80% of fossil fuels in the ground, I don't think anyone here will have any confidence that David Cameron or Barack Obama or Angela Merkel and so on will take the action needed against the corporations and big business and so on. Because, you know, let's face it, most politicians have a terrible record on dealing with climate change. The Tories have an especially bad one. I mean, the coalition government promised to be the greenest government ever and ended up investing in fracking and cutting subsidies to fossil fuels, renewable energy, sorry. And Boris Johnson recently rejected a motion to divest from City Hall in London. But I do think that when you look on our side, there is a growing sense that the way to tackle climate change is not to lobby politicians or rely on the Westminster elite to do it for us, but actually what we need to do is build a movement that is confident in bringing attention to the fact that we live in a system that is, you know, completely mad to take no kind of action against one of the biggest problems that we face. And whether it's the 40,000 people who demonstrated last September, or the 20,000 people who demonstrated in March, or the people who have read Naomi Klein's book.
What we have to do, and one of them in Copenhagen, was kind of everyone went in there with such high hopes, and this was going to solve it, and then everyone was so depressed and let down afterwards. I think the thing is to recognise that we want to get the best possible result we can out of Paris, and it won't be good enough. And acknowledging that, going in with a kind of constructive cynicism about it, is going to be the best way forward. So we come out, maybe not the day after the Paris talks finish, you're allowed a day's sleep, but the next day, the movement moving on to see what it can do. And I was just thinking, in terms of you talking about moving, building the movement and divestment, was actually, I suppose it was probably about 18 months ago, I was just down the road in Whitechapel for the launch of the fossil fuel divestment campaign in Britain. And it was quite an amazing launch, actually, because it was basically a mixture of students and churches, which meant there was an interesting cultural mix. And that still, you know, is broadly representative of a lot of the divestment movement. And that really is a great example of building the movement, bringing together people who can see the need for something overcoming their differences, getting together and working together. And you know, the divestment movement is making some real progress, and we're going to see a lot more progress, I think, in the next year or two. The chair put the challenge of talking about growth, which deserves a book, not a minute, but I'll attempt to do it in a minute. I don't think it's very useful to talk about growth, degrowth. The green movement traditionally has got a lot bogged down in that. We're talking about GDP, which is an absolutely useless, pointless, meaningless measure. You cut down a forest, you improve GDP because you're selling the wood, but of course you haven't got the forest. What we need to do is acknowledge we should be doing the things we should be doing in terms of things that are usually considered as development or economic growth, things like insulating homes, putting in renewable energy, putting in public transport, putting in essential social care for everybody who needs it. All of those things we should be doing, and we shouldn't be doing the things we shouldn't be doing, like building new runways at Heathrow or Gatwick, or a whole range of other things. And it's more useful to think in those terms. But we do ultimately have to think about less stuff in our life. And I think Tim Jackson, Prosperity Without Growth, is a book that for me, if you're interested in this issue, is well worth reading, because he shows very much that you cannot decouple production of stuff from carbon emissions. You can cut the carbon intensity, but if you're producing more stuff, you are going to be producing more emissions. And I think what we have to do, and I haven't got time to go into this fully here, but we need to think about progress in new kind of ways. And I think, you know, to offer people the chance of a better life, a more secure, stable life, with everything from a citizen's income to gradually reducing the standard working week so that people have more time to spend doing things they want to do. Maybe they have less stuff in their life, but they have more life and less fear. And that is what we need to be offering people as progress, I think. The question about Green Party and socialist. The problem I have with this is socialists mean lots of things, different things to different people. I've been told, you're a socialist, you want a living wage. And to some people, socialist means a command and control economy on the Russian historic model. So what I tend to say is, I think this is just really confusing the issue and simplifying the issue. My political philosophy is green. And what that means in simple terms is I think everybody has to have access to resources for a decent quality of life, but we all have to collectively do that within the limits of one planet. And we have to be humane and decent to every person and as much as we can everything, every living thing on that planet. And that's the green political philosophy for me, and that's, is very much a philosophy about economics and the structure of society as much as it is about the structure of how we treat the environment.
Thank you very much, Natalie.
Okay, actually I'll start with that point. I mean, obviously it's not for me to say, to tell the Green Party whether it should be socialist or not. Hint, yes you should. but I'm not a member, so I won't talk about that. But just about the sort of the wider point about the relationship between sort of the Labour movement and Greens, sort of small g Greens. I think there's obviously an issue here, but I think there's a perception often that Greens are these kind of middle class, sort of judgmental types who come down and say, oh, you working class people are doing things wrong. And a lot of, and some of kind of the green movement generally, not green specifically, but has been about, telling working people that they have to do things that actually they can't afford to do. As you said, solar panels. It's all very well to say, everyone, you have to put solar panels on your roof, but if you don't have several thousand pounds to do it, you can't do it. And actually, if you don't own your roof, you can't do it. If you live in a rented place, you can't do it. So this is kind of, I think there has been a problem there with not understanding the reality of working people's lives. I think that there's also kind of an assumption that sectional interests will always trump anything else. So this assumption that, if you're a miner, if you come from a mining area, therefore you will always be in favour of mining. And I think that really does working people a disservice. I mean, people may remember a couple of years ago now, there was a big succession of very large strikes among miners in Spain. And what was really, really striking about them is that they weren't saying, right, you've got to keep the mines open forever because we want jobs. They were saying, right, we want a just transition to sustainable employment. There's other things that we could do that wouldn't destroy the environment. But the government isn't actually taking any steps towards transferring us to those. They're just saying, well, we'll cut your wages and we'll make some of you unemployed. And that isn't the way to do it. Similarly, there was an occupation in a car plant quite near to me, the Vistian plant, several years ago now, and I went up there to see the occupiers because I just lived down the road. And they again were saying, well, we know that actually what we're doing here, making vans, is bad for the environment. We shouldn't really be making all these new vans because they're just going to pollute and cause climate change. But we could make anything, they said. We could make solar panels. We could make wind turbines. You know, turn this factory into something that's actually socially useful and progressive. And that was the workers themselves arguing for that. So I think the idea that, you know, that the labour movement is sort of structurally opposed to the green issues is really wrong. And I think the more that we work together, the more that actually, you know, people who care about climate change go to the Durham Miners' Gala. That's, yeah, this is all progress, I think. On the growth question, I mean, I think there is obviously, it's kind of a, you know, logic says that you have a finite planet. At some point, you must reach a point where you can't support any more people on it because you have reached a finite limit of resources. The question really is not so much whether there is a finite limit, it's whether we're close enough to it that it's relevant, in a sense. And I think the point about the problem with the argument about human ingenuity, with respect to the chair who put the question, is that we've seen the effect of limitless human ingenuity up until now, and it looks like 4 degrees plus of warming, because that human ingenuity has partly at least pumped more and more emissions into the atmosphere. So I don't think we can say, well, we'll always just find more inventions to get ourselves out of this. But what we have to ask is, well, okay, actually an awful lot of indications are showing that we are up against the natural limits in terms of the pollution that we're causing, the, you know, depletion of rare metals and so on. But actually, well, is this because this is what humans are like and there's just too many people on the planet? Or is this that we live in a fundamentally polluting and wasteful system? And I think the answer is B, that actually it's not us who don't fit on the planet, it's increasing that doesn't fit on the planet. And this is just another illustration that actually if we had a different system, if we could get rid of this system, actually I think we wouldn't be up against natural limits. We wouldn't be having to be asking that question all the time. We would be able to implement the solutions that we know are out there to mean that we would be living in a sustainable way and using our resources sustainably. The third point about built-in obsolescence. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of obvious, isn't it? But of course, if you're a capitalist and you're making something that's going to last for 50 years, at some point it's going to occur to you that this isn't the best strategy for my business. I will make it so it breaks in 2 years. And again, I don't think there's a way actually within the system of solving that. You could try and have regulations about how long things are supposed to last, but we already do because we have the Sale of Goods Act. Actually, it says there that things should last a reasonable amount of time, and if they don't, if they break sooner, you can take it back to the manufacturer. But actually, how many people here have ever tried that and succeeded? I mean, you know, it doesn't work. So I think, again, I mean, capitalism is going to do what capitalism is going to do, and in the end, the way is to get rid of the system. Which brings me to the final point, which is really about the role of what I hope will be very, very big protests in Paris. I mean, I think I really urge everyone to go to Paris, to be part of the process here as well, you know, because I think that's fantastically important. But I think we have to understand what we're trying to do, because I think that the guy at the back is absolutely right. We're not protesting in Paris because we think that all the world leaders will go, oh, you want to stop climate change? Oh, right, sorry, we'll get right on that. You know, we do have to go into this with our eyes open. The point about those protests is exactly the same as the point of the protest last Saturday. It's exactly the same as the point of the protest in Manchester at the Tory conference. It's saying, right, we are going to make ourselves ungovernable. We are going to shut down this city until you take real action on climate change, until you actually do something. And we are going to keep on doing it. So you can't just say, oh, well, we'll go to a different city and have protests somewhere else, because we will follow you. And we will make that city ungovernable. And we will keep on. We are not going to put up with this inaction any longer. And it's that sort of rolling protest. If you get that going, if you build a big enough movement that can sustain that over summit after summit, meeting after meeting, that's when you get to the pitch where the governments have to start thinking, well, actually, we can't get away. We're just not doing anything any longer. So that, I think, is the point.
Thank you. Let's move to make a quick announcement.
Well, I just wanted to make the point that, but Elaine's done it really well about the issue about unions and, the defence industry is obviously one that I have troubles with, but we need to find those people different constructive things to do. But I did just wanted to comment. I was talking about the growth and the surge in activism, and just around the corner from here, actually, there was the City Sprint Bicycle Couriers, and it was the best piece of union organising I've ever seen. I was on their picket line a week or so back. These are freelancers who have no security of employment. They're paid by the parcel they're delivered. They're being paid the same price in pounds per parcel that they were 15 years ago. And they went out on strike. And so I think we're also seeing a real upsurge in union activism. And you know, let's all get behind that and encourage that and see that fitted together.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thank you all. Very interesting session. This session is now closed, but we've just to, with